Morning, everyone. Myself, Dr. Smriti. I'm senior resident in the Department of Ophthalmology. Today, I'm going to present a lecture on the topic uvea, its anatomy, its physiology, and its clinical correlations. This topic is divided into two parts. The first part will be studying the basic introduction to the topic uvea and the detailed study about iris. Basic outline is the introduction, the embryology of the uveal tract, the congenital anomalies of the uveal tract, iris, its anatomy and nerve supply, ciliary body, its anatomy and nerve supply, choroid, its anatomy and blood supply of the uveal tract, and the clinically applied aspects. Now the introduction, the term uvea is coined from the Latin word uva. Uva means grape. It is the middle vascular coat of the eyeball. And from anterior to posterior, it can be divided into iris, ciliary body, and choroid. As we can see, this is the anterior uvea, consists of the iris here, the ciliary body, and third, the choroid, which is called the posterior uvea. Its functions are, it regulates the light entry and anchors the lens, which is the function of iris and ciliary body, absorbs the reflected light, which is the function of the choroid, the light which falls on the inner side of the eyeball. It is absorbed by the reflected light is absorbed by the uvea, the choroid. It also provides nourishment as it is the vascular coat. It consists of vascular supply. Now, the uvea is firmly attached to the sclera at three points in eyeball. First is the scleral spur. Second is the exit point of the vertex veins. And third is the optic nerve. These are the sites where the uvea is tightly, firmly adherent to the sclera. Now the embryology, the neuroectoderm and the mesenchymal tissue. These two structures, they derive the structure of the uvea. And from neuroectoderm, the epithelial layers of the iris, the sphincter and the dilator pupillary muscles, and epithelial layers of the ciliary body, they are derived. And from the periocular mesenchyme, the blood vessel of the iris, choroid and ciliary body, the stroma of the iris and the ciliary muscle and the stroma of the ciliary body and choroid are derived. Now the milestones. By the 9th week of gestation, ciliary body begins to appear in the gestation. By the 12th week of gestation, sphincter pupillae appears. By 4th month, ciliary processes are fully formed. By 5th, the iris and the choroid are formed. By the 6th month, the dilator muscle begins to form sphincter muscle fully and differentiated. In the postnatal period, the dilator muscles reach adult proportion by the age of 5 years. So at the time of birth, we can see now that the sphincter muscles are fully differentiated. They are fully developed, but the dilator muscles are not fully developed. Therefore, that is why in the neonatal period or in children, the pupil size is difficult to dilate. The pupil does not dilate fully. Sometimes strands of this tissue are left as persistent pupillary membrane, which can be seen here. These are the strands of the tissue. It is also called as persistent pupillary membrane. Towards the end of the gestation, the central iris stroma, it disappears, which forms the pupil. The persistent papillary membrane represents the remnants of vascular sheath of the lens. The strands they arise from and insert into the iris collarette. This is the feature that differentiates it, that it is arising and inserting into the iris collarette only. This is the collarette. This is the irregular ragged edges on the pupil. The dilator muscle is not apparent until 6 months, and differentiation of myoepithelial cells continues after birth, which is the cause of pupillary meiosis. Now, the iris. The iris word is a Greek word which means color halos or rainbows. It is a thin, pigmented, contractile circular structure which is analogous to the diaphragm of a camera. This is the anterior extension of the uveal tract, as we have seen earlier. The uveal tract was divided into iris, choroid, ciliary body, and choroid. So the anterior part is iris. It extends from the iris root to the iris margin, which is called the pupil, the central aperture, which is 3 to 4 millimeter in size. It lies on the anterior lens surface surrounded by aqueous humor. It is attached to the middle of anterior surface of the ciliary body. Now the functions of the iris, the primary function of the iris is that it regulates the light entry into the eye. And it also gives a distinctive color to the eye. Now the gross anatomy of iris. Iris has two surfaces, the anterior and the posterior surface. The anterior surface is, as we can see here, it is rough, and the posterior surface, that is smoother. The average diameter of iris is 12 millimeter. The collarette is thickened iris, 0.6 to 1 millimeter wide, and located 2 millimeter from the pupillary margin. This is the pupillary margin. From 2 millimeter, the ragged thickened iris is present, which is called collarette. Here also we can see, this is collarette. This is the pupillary margin. Anteriorly, iris is divided into two parts by this collarette. The inner pupillary zone, 1 to 2 millimeters wide, and the outer ciliary zone, which is 3 to 4 millimeters wide. This is the inner pupillary zone, and this is the outer ciliary zone. From collarette to the iris root, and from collarette to the pupillary margin, it is the inner pupillary zone. The thickness of the iris is 0.5 millimeters. It is thickest at collateral. It is thickest at collarette, which we have seen previously. Thinnest at the root, and the thin regions, for example, like iris root and the margins, they are more susceptible to the tearing in injuries. And the separation of the root of the iris is also called as iridodialysis. As we can see here in this picture, this is inferior temporally, the iris root has detached. Iris has been detached from its root, and the pupil that appears to be a D-shaped pupil. Now the posterior surface. Posterior surface is dark brown or black in color. It looks comparatively smoother than the anterior surface. And under magnification, there are Schwalbe's contraction folds present. and radial furrows, which commence at 1 millimeter from the papillary border. These are the radial furrows, starts 1 millimeter from the papillary border. Now, the contact between the posterior surface of the iris and the anterior capsule of the lens is altered, also altered by the pupillary size. It is greatest in the mid-dilatation and can precipitate angle closure glaucoma in some predisposed eye with narrow angle. Now, the iris macroscopic appearance. The pupillary zone and the ciliary zone, as we can see here. This is the pupillary zone, which is divided by the collarette. It's 2 millimeter from the pupillary margin up to the collarette. And the ciliary zone is from the collarette to the ciliary root of the iris. The pupillary zone is 1.6 millimeter wide. It begins at the margin of pupil, also called as pupillary ruff, which is the anterior termination of the iris pigmented epithelium. It has lots of connecting crest and deep radial slits or ridges, which are known as Fuchs crypts or somepts, due to a radial arrangement of the vessel and connective tissue. As you can see, they are radially arranged, so radial ridges or slits are present, which are called Fuchs crypts. The ciliary zone is divided into three areas: the inner smooth areas, the middle furrowed area contraction, responsible for contraction. Contraction furrows are there, which can be seen here. And the marginal cribriform area, which can be seen on gonioscopy. And the peripheral crypts are present in this area. These crypts, they have their function. These are the sites where we use to do peripheral iridectomy by laser, because at these crypts, the iris is very thin, and we can easily make an hole via laser. Iridectomy can be easily made here. Now, the microscopic structure of the iris. There are four layers: the anterior limiting layer. This is the anterior limiting layer, the stroma of the iris, the anterior epithelial layer, and the posterior pigmented epithelial layer. So the four layers of the iris, which can be seen in microscope, they are anterior limiting layer, iris stroma, anterior epithelial and posterior pigmented epithelial layer. Now, the anterior limiting membrane, it is a condensed part of the stroma, consists of melanocytes and fibroblasts. It is deficient in the areas of crypts, very thin at contraction furrows. It also determines the color of the iris. That there are three types of intercellular junctions present. There are gap junctions, intermediate junctions, and discontinuous tight junctions. Now, the color of the iris is determined by the character of the melanin and amount of the pigmentation, but not by the number of the melanocytes. It is the pigments which are responsible, not the number of the melanocytes. So melanocytes are present in the anterior limiting membrane. Blue iris is relatively free of pigmentation. Therefore, it absorbs long waves of light, but it reflects shorter blue wave, giving the blue color to the eyes. As it has lesser pigmentation, so it absorbs the long waves and reflects the shorter blue waves, so that we see a blue color of the eye. The brown iris, which has abundant stromal pigmentation. So the brown iris, as we can see, it is because of the pigmentation of the iris. There can be benign proliferation of uveal melanocytic cells, which is called as iris nevus or iris nevi. This is the pigmentation, sectoral pigmentation, as we can see, due to the proliferation of the uveal melanocyte. It can be benign condition or it can be a malignant transformation. When it is a benign condition, we call it only as iris nevi, iris nevus. And the malignant transformation of iris nevus can lead into a disease called iris melanoma, condition called iris melanoma. Here we can see iris melanoma is there. So the importance of anterior limiting membrane was that it consists of melanocytes and fibroblasts, and it determines the color of the iris. And few areas in which these are deficient, anterior limiting membrane is absent, they are the areas of the crypts and also at the contraction furrows. So at these areas, we are able to do the laser peripheral iridectomy. Now, the second part is stroma of the iris. It is the main bulk of the iris tissue, consisting of loosely arranged collagenous network with mucopolysaccharides, ground substance containing the sphincter pupillae muscle, the dilator pupillae muscle, the vessels and the nerves of the iris, and the cellular elements like fibroblast, melanocytes, clump cells, and mast cells. See in this picture, this is the anterior limiting layer in the brown color. Then this is the iris stroma. Iris stroma, here is, we can see at near the pupillary margin, this is the sphincter muscle, which is present in this iris stroma. And there are minor arterial circles. The blood vessels are also present. And different fibroblasts and melanocytes also. Now the iris muscles, that there are two types of iris muscles located in the stromal layer of the iris. Here in the picture, we see this is the stroma, this is the pupillary space. So this makes it the pupillary iris. This is the sphincter pupillae muscle. And this is the dilator pupillae muscle. Along with it, we can see it here near the pupil. This is the sphincter pupillae. And radially, these are the dilator pupillae. The sphincter muscle in the pupillary zone and the dilator muscle in the ciliary zone. This is the pupillary zone and this is the ciliary zone. Similarly here. The sphincter muscle, it is oriented parallel to the pupillary margin. See, concentrically to the pupillary margin. It measures 0.075 millimeter in diameter and has thickness of 0.1 to 1.7 mm. The contractions, when the sphincter pupillae contracts, it causes constriction of the pupil, which is called meiosis. And it is supplied by parasympathetic nerve. So even after broad iridectomy, when iridectomy is done, which removes a sector of iris sphincter, the remaining sphincter can still constrict the remaining pupillary margin. Now the dilator muscle, which is present in the ciliary zone of the iris, is 4 microns in thickness and oriented radially from the iris root towards the pupil. It is oriented radially from the root towards the pupil. So when the muscle contracts, it pulls the pupillary margin towards the ciliary body, dilating the pupil. And it is supplied by the sympathetic nerve. As we can see in this picture, when the parasympathetic supply is there, nerve supply, the sphincter pupillary muscle contraction decreases the pupil size. Parasympathetic nerve supply causes the sphincter pupillary contraction, which constricts the pupil, causing the meiosis. And when the sympathetic nerve supply is present, the dilator pupillary muscle contracts and it dilates the pupil, dilating the pupil, causing mitriasis. It is called mitriasis. Now the stroma also contains the blood vessels, which forms the bulk of the stroma, and they arise mainly from sarcolemma arteriosus major. Some of them also arise directly from the anterior ciliary arteries, and these blood vessels are responsible for radial streaks seen on the anterior surface of iris. The peculiarities of the iris are there is absence of internal elastic lamina, and there is non-fenestrated capillary endothelium. These are the peculiarities of the iris blood vessels. There is no internal elastic lamina and it is non-fenestrated capillary endothelium. Now the stroma also contains the cells, the fibroblasts, the melanocytes, the clump cells and the mast cells. The fibroblasts, they are most common stromal cells and they are found around the blood vessels, nerves, muscles, tissue and throughout the iris substance. The melanocytes, they are branching elements with the processes and contains melanin granules. The clump cells, they are large round pigmented cells without the processes and they are filled with inclusion granules. The mast cells, they are round and have villi, the villous processes. The extracellular matrix of the stroma, it contains type 6 collagen, laminin and fibronectin. So as we see, the stroma contains many things and it forms the main bulk of the tissue, intermixed with the collagenous network and mucopolysaccharide, which is the ground substance. The muscles, it contains the muscles of the iris, blood vessels and nerves and cellular elements. The muscles include the sphincter and the dilator pupillary muscle. The blood vessels, they are mainly from sarcolemma arteriosus major and anterior ciliary arteries also. And these are responsible for the radial streaks. And the blood vessels also don't have internal elastic lamina and non-fenestrated capillary endothelium. The cells, these are fibroblasts, which are present in the stroma, fibroblasts, melanocytes, the clump cells and the mast cells. And the extracellular matrix, it is made up of type 6 collagen. Now the anterior epithelial layer, which is the anterior continuation of pigment epithelium of ciliary body. It does not have any melanocytes. And basal processes of the cells of this layer give rise to the dilator pupillary muscle. So, as we see, it is the continuation of pigment epithelium of ciliary body, but it is not responsible for pigment of iris. It does not have any melanocytes. The color of iris it depends on the anterior layer, that anterior limiting membrane, this layer, anterior limiting membrane, it is responsible for the color of the iris. Now the posterior pigment epithelial layer. Now this is called pigmented. It is pigmented, darker in color, as we can see in this picture. This is the posterior pigmented layer. It is the anterior continuation of non-pigmented epithelium of ciliary body, which in turn is the continuation of the sensory retina. As you see, there is a contradiction in the name of derivation. The anterior epithelial layer is the continuation of the pigment epithelium of ciliary body, but it does not have melanocytes. And the posterior pigment epithelial is the continuation of the non-pigment epithelium of ciliary body. It contains abundant columnar dipigmented cells. It curves around the pupillary margin here. It curves around the pupillary margin and extends for a short distance onto anterior border layer of erythroma, forming the pigment trough. See here, it curves around the pupillary margin and extends for a distance onto the anterior border as the pigment trough. See, when the iris pigment epithelium present on the anterior surface of the iris, normally the pupillary trough is 0.1 mm, up to 1 mm. The normal pigment trough, it is up to 1 mm. When it extends it and present on the anterior surface of the iris, then it is called ectropion UVA. It can be congenital or can be associated with rubeosis iridis, that is neovascularization of the iris. Or it can also be present in the cases of neurofibromatosis. In this case, we see there are new blood vessels, small branching blood vessels on the iris surface. We can see these are the neovascularization of the iris. These blood vessels, they bleed frequently and they cause contraction. They constrict. When they cause contraction, they pull the posterior surface of the iris anteriorly, causing the ectropion UV. The contact between the posterior surface of the iris and the lens, posterior surface of the iris and the lens, it creates a relative pupillary block to the aqueous humor flow through the pupil, which is more marked in dilatation. See, we have seen earlier that the position of the pupil, it affects the relative position of iris and the lens. So if there is pupillary block in mid-dilated, the space between the anterior surface of the lens and the iris becomes very less. So in mid-dilatation, it causes blockage of the aqueous humor flow and it accumulates behind the iris. It cannot come outside in the anterior chamber. So it collects behind the iris and it causes the anterior bowing of the iris, which may cause angle closure glaucoma. See, in this picture we can see this is the iris anteriorly bowed. This is the lens and the mid-dilated position of iris. The aqueous humor is secreted from the ciliary body, ciliary processes. It cannot go into the anterior chamber for drainage, for proper drainage. It accumulates here in the posterior segment, in the posterior chamber, and causes the forward bowing of iris, leading to the angle closure glaucoma. Now, the applied anatomy of iris, we can see there can be iris nodules, which are accumulated deposits of epithelioid cells and lymphocytes. They are deposited onto the iris without any tissue destruction. When they are present at the pupillary margin, at the pupillary border, they are called as copase nodule. And when they are present near collarette or near the base, they are called Busakas nodules. So it is easy to remember, like when near the base, the nodule are called Busakas. The base is equal to Busaka. So vice versa, at the pupillary border, the copase nodules are present. There can be atrophy of the iris. It can be segmented or present in patches. They are the areas of the degeneration of iris. There is shedding of the iris pigments from these areas. So as we can see, there are very few melanocytes here. These areas appearance, they appear very light in color, atrophied. They are commonly seen in iridocyclitis. This condition can also be present in case of herpetic iridocyclitis, and also in cases of pseudo exfoliation and pigment dispersion syndrome. So these are the few iris features which we have studied. The main function of the iris we have studied in this lecture. The anatomy, the basic microscopic structure, and the applied anatomy. In the next structure, we are going to discuss about the ciliary body and the choroid, their clinically applied anatomy. Thank you.